to the 911 call. The CAD report indicates that the 911 call was made, I believe, at 9:11. Is that correct, on the morning of?
I believe it was 9:15.
I'm sure you're right, 9:15 on the morning of October 12th. That's roughly what, 6 minutes after the victim left the restaurant? I believe his ticket said, his receipt says, it's still on the screen here, that he left at 9:09. At least that's when he paid.
9:09 to 9:15 would be about 6 minutes. Yes.
And the defendant made the call to Covenant at 9:04. Right, you indicated you reviewed the records to the, I believe the MDT records, but indicated that Mr. Teeter had contacted Covenant, indicating he didn't want to drive with the victim, he wanted the co-driver at that point.
There was a message sent, yes, at 9:04.
And that message, from what you can tell, that message came from Mr. Teeter to and went to Covenant.
Yes.
So at 9:04, would you agree that the victim, that Mr. Stevens, is still inside the iron skillet at this point?
Mr. Stevens, yes.
Right. So Mr. Stevens is still the iron skillet, and that's when Mr. Teeter made the call while he was still there inside the restaurant.
Mr. Stevens was still inside the restaurant.
Now, you questioned Mr. Stevenson on November 13th of 2018 while he was still in the hospital. You just stated that a couple minutes ago, correct?
Yes, I took a statement from him.
And he indicated to you in the course of that statement that he and Mr. Teeter were friends, at least they got along up until October 12th.
I believe he did, yes.
And so the records that you were able to extract from the phone are consistent with that representation, that they were friends or at least got along up until that point. There had been no complaints.
Yes.
So those findings are not necessarily shocking or surprising to anyone having spoken to Mr. Stevens, correct?
That's correct.
You're not aware of Mr. Teeter making any statements to the contrary to anything?
No, I'm not.
Now, when you met with Mr. Stevens on the 13th, was that your first time meeting the Mr. Stevens?
Yes.
And prior to going to the hospital to take his statement, you had received clearance from the hospital that it was okay to do so?
I got information from the hospital that he was awake and available. He spoke to.
Right. Now, if you had inquired if the witness was available, they would tell you he's not in a position to speak or is unable to speak or is medically impaired, he can't speak or something to that nature.
Yes, if he was physically unable to speak,
right.
Yes.
So you went to the hospital, take that statement with the understanding that it was okay, at least medically, to do so once you got there.
I went to the hospital with the understanding that he was physically able to speak. Yes.
Okay. So when you got there, he's understandably weak from surgery, maybe weak from whatever medicine he had been taking, but did he otherwise understand your questions when you posed them to him?
Yes.
Did he ever indicate to you during the course of that statement, hey, listen, I'm under the influence of some heavy drugs here, I can't talk to you at all, I can't follow what it is you're saying or asking?
No.
Did he ever complain that he was in pain while you were there, that would interrupt his ability or to understand the questions that were being posed to him?
Not that I recall.
Now, do you have a copy of the statement, the November 13th statement, in front of you while you're testifying right now?
No, I don't.
Do you recall if he indicated, well, let me back up. He relayed to you that he had some words with Mr. Teeter at the iron skillet, right?
Yes.
And that Mr. Teeter paid his bill, left.
Yes.
Mr. Stevens continued to finish his meal, then paid his bill and left. And that's reflected by the two receipts that are up on the screen.